Let's welcome Ralph on stage, who is from East GmbH here in Germany. And he gives us a talk about everything is a component, site development with composite pages. So let's welcome Ralph on stage.
Okay. Good. Let's talk about Composome today. But at first, about me. I'm a developer, I think a core developer. And I'm a Sling enthusiast since 10 years. And yes, there's an anniversary. And yeah, I have waited a long time for a CMS like AEM, which is open source. And because I have made projects in AEM and I have made projects in a low cost project or in open source project, and I had the hope that I can avoid the switch of my mind between the low cost projects and the AM projects. And yeah, the question was, there was a long time and no such CMS was at the horizon, and the question was, can we make such a thing? And so we have started a first first test project in 2015. In 2015, this was the Composome console. I think it's always known as Composome, which is meanwhile a part of the Sling starter. But this was a kind of our warm-up project. Can we do such a thing? And in the next year, I have presented here in a Lightning talk a first prototype of a new module called Pages or Composome Pages. And then comes a long time of work. And in the last week, we have published our first final release of Composome Pages. This is a CMS, and I think it's a little bit similar to AEM, and it's open source. Okay, let's talk about Composome. Composome is not only the console, which is part of the Sling starter. Composome consists of some modules. There are four modules today, currently, and the nodes module contains the console API, this is a framework, and the tools based on this API. The platform module is a service module for release and access management. We can see the work of the platform module later. The pages module is a content management solution. And the assets module is also developed since 2015, I think. But this is currently deferred before there is a refactoring necessary that this module supports the release management, which is implemented in the platform module. And I hope we can talk about this next year at Adepto. Okay. You can get more information on your new homepage about Composome. This homepage is made with Composome and on the Composome Cloud, which is open for everyone which wants to try Composome at a live system. Okay, what services are in the Composome modules? The nodes module contains the console API, the browser, the package manager, and the usage manager. And some basic services for the other modules, a client lib implementation, and a basic tech library. The platform module is on top of this, a module for content staging, for release management, and for the access management. Later more. The asset manager, we have seen it, is intended for managing of responsive assets. But I think we talk about this module in the next year. And today, we will focus our talk to Composum Pages. The Composum Pages module is an editing user interface with a component development framework and some editing widgets. And we will see this Pages module live later in the demo, working with this module and developing of components with this module. Okay, how we do need the platform module? The platform module is a module which is designed to give us the ability to set up one system for all. One system for authoring and for publishing on one system, for development environments, for small installations, and probably, if the experiences are good, for clusters of unique nodes. The platform module is establishing a filter chain for each request. Each request which is incoming into our system is analyzed and the access mode is determined at first. The access mode is determined using tables of authoring hosts which are configured in the OSGI. And after this filter step, the access mode is determined. And now the Pages module, we can see it later, is looking for the requested site and for the requested release of content. And with this information, the platform module is wrapping the request and creating a resource resolver, which is implements the API of the resource resolver based on the version store. Yes, this resolver is called the staging resource resolver, and this resolver makes it easy to render components on versions. This resource resolver is a core part of our implementation, and this resolver is designed and placed in the in the platform module because the assets module should use this, and the Pages module also. And then the filter chain can then more filter steps. For example, a cache filter, which is an include cache, a Sling include cache, which is shipped with the platform. And finally, the request is, or the final markup is rendered by Pages modules. Okay, what does the Pages module in this filter chain? The Pages module is called is placed in the filter chain at the second place, and the Pages module is analyzing the request and determining the site which should deliver the content, and then is looking in the release table of this site and is also determining the release which is requested. And with this both information, the platform filter in the next step can create its resource resolver. And finally, the components of the Pages module are the rendering components. Okay. How is a Pages site organized? A Pages site contains at top of the of the entity tree is a site placed. A site is an explicit created resource, which is the root of each website, which contains all pages, all assets of this site, and which provides some global information, some global settings for all pages. And it's determining the set of languages supported by a site. It's organizing the content releases of a site. And yeah, it contains pages. A page is one single web page with probably various languages. Yes, the one site can deliver more than one language, and the languages can also be split in the page, but you can decide which strategy you will do with pages, and yeah, we can show this later. The next step on a page are containers. Containers are elements, and the containers are arranging elements within. It's like a parses in AEM. And the last level of this hierarchy are the elements. And the assets or file-based resources are also part of a site and should be children in the repository of this site. And sites and pages are both created by copying the initial structure from templates, and both are referencing design policies in the templates for which are containing rules, which component can be part of which component, which container can contain which element. These design policies are placed in the templates, and the templates are referenced by sites and by pages. Okay. Here a list of all the features of Composum, but I think we should finish our short introduction into the pages and Composum modules, and should switch to our topic today, the pages components. Take a look at the pages UI, and you will find here a lot of components. Such a content component we see in the middle in the page, which is we will see in the middle this such a component is a normal content component, and a content component consists more smaller components for editing. Toolbars are part of each content component, and this toolbar is if a content component is selected are placed into the tools in the main navigation on the left, in the context tools on the right, the toolbar on the top, and also in the toolbar of the selection. And another part of a component is a tile component. This is for overviews for this context tool, which is container structure tool, and for the type, the component type itself in the in the component selector widgets. Okay, there are some other tools on the left. Each tab on the left is a Sling component, which is for main navigation. Each tools on the left are selection independent, and on the right we have the context tools, and all the context tools are depending on the current selection and are changed and replaced according to the current selection if the selection is changed. Okay, let's build an example. We would implement a new component, a simple image component, and such a component is a resource, is declared as a resource, and the main feature or the main key in this declaration is the primary type. Each component of type CPP component is managed by the component manager and can be selected in the component editing UI. There's another attribute, a category, that is for filtering and grouping of such component. And another important information is the component type. Each component has to be such a component type, and you can specify it explicitly, or you can inherit it from your supertype. And a main thing of the of such a component is the rendering template or this rendering script. And this rendering script is a GSP in this CMS. I think it's a controversial point, but we have made the decision that we use JSPs because we want to embed all and editing hints or editing code into the page, and we need a thing, and that is a tag, which can be generate various markup according to the different display modes. Yes, and the CPP element tag is necessary for each component, and is the topmost tag in your rendering template, and this is rendering all the editing hints around this element. Such a tag is defining a model, and there are a lot of prepared models in the Composer module, and you can use it from scratch, or you can build your own models. Sling models are also possible. And inside of this tag, you have the normal component tag, component markup is written. You can see here an image tag, and I think an image tag is our solution for the problem discussed yesterday. How can I render an image or a link in the same way at any place? Okay, we have discussed it. Yes, we use a tag clip. Probably we can add later more or support later more scripting engines because the tools are not depending on the tags. We are only depending on the generated markup. And we can replace this engine later, probably in the next release. And ideas are welcome, contributors are welcome to do that. Okay, let's try it now. Oh, stop. Now the demo. So, it's demo time. You can see here the editing UI of Composer pages with the main navigation on the left, the pages tree and assets tree, the component selector, and okay, this inbox is part of the Cloud installation is an extension. And on the right side, we can see the context tools. And if I select, ich bin nicht angemeldet. Okay, I wasn't logged in, and there were some errors here. You can see the context tools on the right. And if we want to create our own component, we can set up our project, we can type our code and can build this and can deploy it. But there's another way to create a component. You can switch to the develop mode in this. UI. And if you have switched on the develop mode, you have here another tab. And on this tab, you can see here the resolver search path, the apps and the libs folder. And it's a little bit slow. With a prepared project, an abstract tenant, an abstract app domain, and a project in this domain, and a components folder. And in this components folder, we can create a component. This is an image component. Okay, we need a type or a supertype. I select a type here. A short description and our categories. It should be an image component, and okay, it's for testing. And then I can create a component. Okay, I find the component here, and there are prepared scripts. I can open one for the rendering of the component, and one for the property dialog, and for the tile, this is shown on the right. There are some scripts prepared to make your customization of this tile. We can edit this later, and at first, let's fill in our rendering script. I have prepared a rendering script here for copying. Okay. Yes, this is right. Okay. So it's our simple GSP, our element tag around, and the image within. And it's based on a prepared model. And there's a shortcut to build CSS classes in a VEM-like mode. This is embedding the resource type of this component, and so the CSS keys are very long, but very good separated. And if this component is not valid because it's not no image referenced, or the reference is invalid, then we have here embedded another component or another thing is a placeholder, and for this thing we need also a script. Let's save this and go to our component and add our placeholder. This is a simple icon, and we need this later to become a drop zone if this image is invalid. Okay. Is this correct? I think. Okay. And we need our dialogue. The dialogue for this component is really simple. There are only three widgets within, one for the image reference, one for the image title, and the alternative text. You have nothing to do else. And if you save this and we make some hints that we can easily find our component in this thing. Let's change the icon of our tire. Okay. And for the title, we should make a red background so we can find our component easier. Okay, that's all. And now let's go back to our page. This is our test page. It's containing some other content here. And if we switch to our component selector, it's not visible here, but if we reload, you can see our new component on the left with the right background we have edited and our icon. And you can now tag this and place this here. Here. And add your properties. These three properties we have declared in the dialog. Let's select any image. The other is not necessary. So, and we can see here our component, which is placed on our page. And yes, you can see we need some styling. It's not the right format. And if we take a look to the other components and select such an image, you can see this component is erect and signals that this is a drop zone, but our component doesn't do that. And we should extend on our component. Okay, let's go back to our image and edit this. And to the prepared code. Okay. And let's declare a drop zone around our content. A drop zone is also a simple tag. You have to declare the property which should be changed or modified if an asset is dropped in it. And you have to declare what kind of element which can be dropped in this drop zone. In this case, it's an asset of type image. You can also say an asset of type video, or you can also say declare drop zones for pages. In this case, a page link is dropped into this element. And yeah, try it, and there are some possibilities. And if we save this and reload our page and go to the asset selector, and if we then you can see our image is also reacting on this, and we can drop it. And hopefully it works. Yes. And the image is placed in your new image component. Okay, and yet, now about, now we should add some styling to our component, but the styling is not supported in our integrated tools. And let's switch to a project, which is prepared here in my preferred IDE. You can here see a Maven project, which is for a tenant, application domain, and declares an app with a bundle and a package, and the same structure we can see here in the content. And we have now implemented our image component here in the components folder. Let's get the implemented code. So we can find here our image. All we have edited in the UI are now, all these things are now available in our IDE. And I've prepared a CSS for this image. Let's copy it here in our project. It's a simple CSS that makes that ensures that our image is not wider than the current page width and is centered if it is smaller than the page width. Quite simple, but how this CSS code comes to the client. We have to implement our own client library. This client library is simply a resource node of type nodes commons client lib with a category within, and this category is as category is declared here, the Composum Pages Components View, and Composum Pages Component View is a category with, which is used by the components which are part of the Composum implementation. The Composum module comes with a set of predefined components and with a client library, and with this category, we are extending this client lib with our code, and the code is referenced here. You have a CSS folder, and the CSS folder contains the reference to our new CSS. And if I build this, it's for the cloud, okay. So I'm building this and deploying it on our cloud instance. Okay, build a success. And let's go back here and reload. Oh. And it doesn't work. Okay. Okay, I think we should clear this later. And okay, we have now implemented our own component, and at the next, I want to extend the other components of the pages UI. And I prepared another example, which is my own widget. Such a widget is a simple widget. It's called confidentiality widget. It's simply an extension of a standard widget, which is a Slack widget, and it declares some default attributes which are used by this basic widget, and so we can use it in all of our content components, and all these things are predefined, and if you change this later, it's changed on all places which are using this. And the select widget, I declare the set of possible values and the default value, and I think this widget should be required by default, and these attributes are declared here, and if I compile this now, I hope. Yes. So it should be on our system. We can check it using the browser. Okay, our widget is now installed here. And then we can extend. Our implementation of our image and use this widget. go to our dialog. This is a simple dialog, and use also the prepared dialog. And I have replaced the last widget in this with two columns with our widget we have replaced and our new widget. This widget is of type confidentiality, and this name is derived from the resources name of our widget. Okay, and let's compile it now once more. Okay, and switch to our and open the dialog, and you can see here our new widget placed in our dialog with the four values we have specified, and we can use it immediately. So. And now our client lib works. There was a caching problem. Because I can see it, the client lib must be reconfigured and rebuilt, and it takes a while on the. And now our image is shrinked to the page assist, or scaled to the page assist, and all is working as expected. And the first example is an extension for the context, a new extension tab. I have prepared it also. In our tools, and I am copying it to our project. There is a new component called MyContext. This MyContext component is is a panel which is displaying the name, the path, and the type of the element which is currently selected. The other code around is to make it looks like the other tools. There's a toolbar placed in there with one button, but the button has no functionality. And to find it easy, the icon is replaced, and there's some red background used to mark it in our user interface, and the question is how is such a component registered in our system, and okay. And for tools components, there is a registry implemented, and this registry is searching for nodes of this resource type, a tools collection. And each child of such a resource collection is registered as a tool with its resource type, with some categories. The categories are important for tools extensions. I specify here with the context category that this is a context tool for the right side that should be React. If an element is selected, if a container is selected, this is not visible, and it should be only visible in the edit and in the develop mode. I have an icon and I can ordering this by this hint on which place in the tab collection this is displayed. Okay, and there's another client lib for this tool with a reference to the styling of my new component, and this is extending the composing pages edit frame client lib. This is a client lib for the frame around our editing page. Okay, and if I build and deploy this, so, and reload my frame. You will find our new component here, our page here, and if I select an element, the context tools are changed, and you can see here in the middle our gradation cap with our new component, and this is marked with the red background, and you can see here I've selected an element, a text element in this column, and it's of type text, and if we select our new component, oh, it's slow. It's very slow. Okay, I can see here our new component with the right resource type, path and name, and this is a simple example how you can extend the tools of the component of the Composum editing UI with your own components. Okay, and finally, let's show how it works together. Let's go to our pages tree, and we have here a site. This is the topmost element, and it's declaring our demo.composum.com site. And with a homepage, this homepage has a teaser to our test page, and our test page here, and our new component in the middle. And if I go to demo.composum.com, and if I reloading this page, so you can see the test page, but our new component is not visible here. And that's clear, because we have changed this test page, and we haven't activated it and published. We have to select our page, and you have to create a new version and activate this. We can do this here in the context menu of a page. So. Let's activate this. Okay. And now, here's the screen. And now switch to my site. Okay, then you can hear, then you can find here the list of modified pages, list of activated pages, and this is, you can find here the new test page, a list of releases, and you can see here is a final release, this is release one, and this release is public, and all activations are collected in the every open next release and part of this next release, and we can finalize this release, but we can also simply say that this release should be our public release, and in this case we can reload it, and our page with the placed image is visible on the public stage. Okay, I think it's quite simple. Okay. Let's go back to our slides. So, we have seen how can you implement components with Composum pages, how can you extend the how can you extend the editing UI of Composum? And feel free to try it. You can try it at the cloud.composum.com site. And everything can create your own tenant. Everything can create its own site and content components and pages. And publishing is not supported by this. You can only test the functionality of Composum. For local installations, look at our setup page. And for this talk, we have prepared also a page, which is shown here. And all the examples we have seen and the introduction is available here. You can read this, you can try it by yourself, and yeah, have fun. Okay, that's all. Any questions?